Good morning. We welcome you to our Facebook Live from Hillcrest Baptist Church on March 29th, 2020. It was interesting this week. I had a young Christian lady who is apparently a student at the University of Tennessee call me. I think she lives in Virginia. That's where the call was from, made. And she said, I also serve with the Tennessee Mission Board, Tennessee Baptist Mission Board, and said, you got anything I need to pray about? I said, of course, I got something to pray about, you know, and I got some people that I've been praying for in our church that some, I think, younger people need to be saved. And she said, okay, anybody else? I said, well, we got people that's been sick, going through cancer and having cancer treatments, and as a matter of fact, my wife is going through. And that young lady prayed one of the prettiest prayers I ever heard a young lady pray. So, boy, that's encouraging when you got kids going to college that can pray like that and just call out to me. Just, I don't know how she picked me out, but she did. And I thank God for that. But anyway, it's amazing to me. I was talking to one of my, a former choir director, 1990. He introduced me to a computer. I didn't know how to turn one on. But he introduced me to a computer, and he is the administrator. He's a church administrator in a pretty large church down in Alabama. Called me this morning. Of course, he keeps up with me. We don't know how Barbara was doing. And so it was interesting how that last week, as we were live on Facebook Live, I had people from North Carolina. I said, that's really interesting. I'm old school, and yet I have come to realize the technology is available to glorify God through Facebook and through YouTube, and I began to utilize that. Thank God for it. I was preaching to people that I used to be their pastor in North Carolina, and on Sunday they listened to me preach. Isn't that amazing? And so I heard from them, and that's just amazing. I get to preach to my Hillcrest folks that have Facebook, and I get to preach to friends of mine that are in North Carolina and other states. It's absolutely amazing. Then I put it on YouTube, and who knows who watches it out there. We just get the word out. God, I'm just grateful that we can use the technology. All right, we've got Angela and Debbie that'll be playing an instrumental here in just a few moments, and we'll begin our service. And then Angela will be singing for us, and God bless you. We're glad you joined in with us, and we hope you get a blessing from the singing and the instrumental and the Word of God. God bless you.
Given the days that we've come from and the days that we have ahead of us, this song has been on my heart, so I hope that you're blessed with the words of it. Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars. I hear the rolling thunder. Thy power throughout the universe display.
Amen.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art.
Oh, yes. Thank you, Jesus.
How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art.
Praise the Lord. Amen.
When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart.
Yes.
Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how
Hallelujah.
Great thou art.
Thank you, Jesus.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art.
Hallelujah. Amen. 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 Thank you, Angie. Amen. Wonderful. Amen. Thank you, Angela. Beautiful. How great thou art. Well, in the this week as I was preparing, I thought that what I would do, get a little head start on my Wednesday night crowd when we got back to church. So we're doing the book of Hebrews on Wednesday night. So I really said I'll get this one and then somehow or another God will give me another message for Sunday. No, I just kept going and kept going. He said, this is not a Wednesday night. Do it on Sunday morning at Facebook Live. So that's what I'm going to do. It's in the book of Hebrews. We'll have it on the screen. We got a few folks here. But if you have your Bibles with you, it'd be Hebrews chapter 2. And we'll be verse 14 through 18. And we're going to pick it up there. We're going to talk about the fear of death. Very relevant subject. I'm seeing people panic today. There's fear in our country. There's fear. Fear is demonstrated by how people respond and how they're hoarding up stuff, you know, and that. And so, but then on the other hand, I see people that are helping people more than they ever did. And on the news this morning, I heard these religious leaders talk about that people are talking more about God now than they ever have, which is a good thing. The problem with that, I've seen this happen many times when a catastrophe comes, such as this virus or such as war, people come to church and then after it gets settled, you know where they go? Right back out again. That's disturbing. They should stay in the house of God. We should stay, remain faithful and dedicated to God and give Him glory and give Him praise. All right, the fear of death. And we're going to look at Hebrews chapter number 2 and verse 14 through 18. For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, and through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil,
and delivered them who through the fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. For verily he took not on himself the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham. Wherefore in all things it behooved him to be made like unto his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make reconciliation for the sins of the people. For in that he himself has suffered, being tempted, he is able to succor them that are tempted. Now, we're going to go over those scriptures again. I just wanted to read them, and then I want to call attention to them. Now, when we think about phobias, it's a persistent irritation, fear, that the specific object really is compelling to his desire to avoid it. You say, we've got people that are afraid of snakes, right? And my barber is one of them. Scared to die. I know she's watching, but I'll tell you what, I could run her off from home with a little green snake. She absolutely has a fear of snakes. And I think that's a good thing, especially to these poison snakes. And there's all kinds of fears. It's an anxiety disorder, and it causes a panic attack. Some people are afraid of spiders. Some folks are, afraid of the dark. And you know, some folks are afraid of clowns. I ain't afraid of a clown, are you? And I'm really not afraid of a spider. And I'm really not afraid of a snake. I respect them. But there's all kinds of them. Some people are afraid that they might be attacked by a shark in a lake or a swimming pool. Now, that's pretty bad phobia, isn't it? They don't usually go in swimming pools unless somebody puts them in there. Some people have a phobia of mirrors. There's just all kinds of different phobias. And so murders. They think some people are afraid to pull the shower curtain back because they're afraid somebody behind there is going to murder them, kill them. All kinds of phobias. I didn't realize they were that many, but they are. Now, the fear of dying without Christ is a real phobia. The fear of dying without Christ should be a real phobia to you, because that can happen. And there ought to be a fear for that. Now, I want to look at, when you look at this disorder, I want to get this, and can cause a panic attack. It is estimated, this is an estimation, I didn't share it a minute ago. It is estimated that more than 30% of U.S. adults have some kind of phobia. I have a little claustrophobia that I didn't know I had, but I do have a little now. And I developed that probably when I was about my 40s, I guess. And so a little bit of claustrophobia. It's not real bad, but I got it. We all got some kind of phobias. Now, but I want to talk to you, how did Satan get the power of death over humanity? How did Satan get the power of death over humanity? Look at verse 14 again. I read it. Let's do exposition on it. For as much, since is a good word there. We could use the word since then, as the children are partakers. Now, these children are born again children of God. That's who he's talking about here. Children are born again children of God, are partakers of flesh and blood. Ladies and gentlemen, those here this morning and those that are listening to right now, we are partakers with you. We got something in common. It's flesh and blood. We've got that in common. He is Christ. He also himself, Christ, likewise took part of the same. He took part of, but not all of. And I got the two Greek words on the screen here, and I'm going to show you the difference in them. And so he took part of the same, but not all of, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil. How do you understand that? That he can destroy death by dying. He said that through death he might destroy him, and that, of course, him is nothing more than Satan, correct? That's him, Satan, might destroy him. But the word destroy does not mean to annihilate, to obliterate, and gone. It doesn't mean that. That word destroy means to render him inoperative. In other words, when you look at it, he doesn't have the power. He doesn't have the power. It means he's kind of useless now. He used to use death, especially in the Old Testament, he used death over the people. They were afraid of death. It was a fearful thing. So to destroy means that when Christ died on the cross, he rendered him useless, and therefore the power of death, that he is the devil. He had that power of death. Power means authority over. So he had the authority over death for all these years. Now, I want you to look at the couple of Greek words that really understand that. Partakers is koinonia, and that's actually where we get the word fellowship. It means to share with others. Now, we do share that with others, flesh and blood. And then the other one took part of, met echo, which means flesh, but not the blood. See, this is where you need to understand that when you say partakers of flesh and blood. Some people say, well, Jesus was partaker of flesh and blood, and therefore he partook of the blood of his mother, partook the blood of his father. That's not true. He doesn't have that in common with us. He's not that kind of a partaker. He took part of the same. He took part of the flesh. He did not take part of the blood. Because as I've taught my people here at Hillcrest, that the blood of every child is determined by the father. The mother doesn't determine the blood of a child. And so the father determines the blood of a child. And therefore, Joseph had nothing to do with the relationship with Mary in the impregnation of her. It was God. It was the Holy Spirit. It was the Holy Spirit that implanted within the womb of Mary Jesus Christ. So you see, the blood of Christ is holy and pure, and that without sin. Even though he partook of the flesh, he did not partake of the blood because he took part of, but not all of. Thank God for that. Now, so we know that by the death he destroyed, he rendered inoperative, useless Satan. He's useless today. He's useless in death. He can't use that against me. I used to be afraid of death. I suppose you guys out there, I guess you were afraid of, you might be afraid of death now. I mean, it's the unknown, but I'm not afraid of death. I'm not. God took that away. Jesus took it away. He dealt with that on the cross, ladies and gentlemen. And so we come to, how did Christ get the power of death over Satan? Well, let's talk about it. Look at verse 15. And delivered them, released them, removed them. And who are them? Got to find out who them are. Believers, born again, children of God. Delivered them, released them, who through fear of death, that phobia of death, were all their lifetime subject under the power of bondage, and that's slavery. Today, ladies and gentlemen, if you're saved by God's grace, born again, you are set free from that. You are free. You're not a slave to sin anymore. The multitude of people out here and running up and down these roads in Blount County, Knox County, Sevier County, Monroe County, and all these counties, if they are not born again, saved by God's grace, they have the fear of death. They are under the domination of the power of Satan. He controls them. And if they be honest with you, they fear death. They might say, well, I'm not afraid to die. I got news for them. They will too. They will be afraid. You just wait till that heart stops. And you just wait till that pain overwhelms them. They will have the fear of death. But let me tell you, God's people, God's born again people die well. They die well. God has taken the sting out of death. See, delivered us. We're from that. We're no longer slaves in bondage. We're no longer a slave to sin. The people outside these walls in this state and those other states in America, they're under the bondage of slavery. They are a slave to Satan. We've been set free, and Jesus has delivered us. We're born again, saved by God's grace, and we ought to celebrate that. Amen? We ought to celebrate that we're free. He delivered us, released us. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 16. For verily, truly, what he did, he took on him the nature of angels. Or he did not, I'm sorry, let me get the negative in there. I left the negative out. For verily, he took not on him the nature of angels. But, in contrast to that, he took on him the seed of Abraham. Now, so when we look at that verse, why didn't he straight come to help the angels? Why didn't he come down here to die for the angels? He didn't take on. He didn't come to help the angels. They're on their own. And I've often wondered, okay, I know that they don't have, they're not saved. Well, what's the difference between an angel and a human? Well, angels are greater in power and intellect. But here's the thing I think is the reason. They were created in heaven. They actually saw God's throne. They actually saw Jesus. They actually was there in the multitude. And they were actually some of the seraphims, who were the angels that praise God. They praise God, the seraphims do. You got seraphims and cherubims in the Bible. You got two different classes of angels. In Isaiah chapter 6, they're seraphims. And they're the ones that praise God. The cherubims are, I think, probably three. You got Lucifer, who was turned out to be the devil, Michael, and Gabriel. Those are the most powerful angels. And so Lucifer decided, he wanted to overthrow God and his throne. So now that he's in heaven, he knows God, he sees God, and all that glory. And then when they sinned and tried to commit a coup to overthrow God, then Michael and the angels come out and fought against the devil, throw the devil out of heaven and down here on the earth, and therefore he lost that realm. He lost it. Now, so when we think about that, he didn't come to help them. Anybody that saw God physically, and they did, the angels saw him physically, verbally, and they saw Jesus, they ain't got a chance to be saved. I ain't going to give them no chance. No. But we've never seen God. We've never seen Jesus. And the way God did it was he sent Jesus here in human being as a seed of Abraham. So he goes on to say he did not take on him the nature of angels. He did not come to help the angels. He did not come to redeem the angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham, the children of Abraham. You say, well, that leaves us out because we're not a children of Abraham. The Jews are children of Abraham. They're the seed of Abraham. By birth, we are the children of Abraham by faith. So what's the difference, ladies and gentlemen? What's the difference? The seed of Abraham, Jews. The seed of Abraham by faith, Gentiles. Amen? We are seed of Abraham. And he came to die and to redeem and to rescue us and to, to restore us back to the part that was messed up, and he did it on the inside. He's got the inside fixed up. The outside ain't fixed up yet. We still go through these hard times with our sinful nature, correct? But let me tell you, one of these days the outside's going to be fixed up. Hallelujah. It's going to be fixed up. We're already fixed up on the inside now. But he's going to fix up the outside one of these days. Maybe it might be closer than we think. Amen? Might be closer than we think. Now, so when we look at this passage of Scripture, Christ became like us. Let me say that. Christ became like us so that we may become like him. Christ became like us that we can become like him. And that's what we are. Ain't we supposed to be like him now? Absolutely. Absolutely. Now, so when we look at this, Christ became, and let me show, when you think about, I got a picture I want to show you here, but I'll wait till I get to it here in just a moment. Now, let me move on just a little further. 2:17. We're four in all things. It behooved Christ. Well, we don't use the word behooved much anymore. The word behooved simply means it was necessary. It behooved him. It was necessary for him. Why was it necessary? What do you think it was necessary for? Wherefore, all things it behooved him to be made. It was necessary for him to be what? Made, created, like unto who? His brethren. Who is that? That's me and you. It was necessary for God to incarnate, send his son down here to this earth to be like us. You got to understand, the Son of God and the Son of Man. It was necessary that he, Christ, might be a merciful Thank God for mercy, right? You ever hear any of these folks say, well, all I want is justice? Do you know where we'd all be if we got that? We'd all be in hell, right? See, in order for the incarnation said he came down here to this planet to be like us, that he could be a merciful. He went through all of our trials. He went through rejection and hatred and temptation. He went through it all. Ladies and gentlemen, I wish we had representatives in heaven that would represent us like Jesus does. Amen. They do a lousy job, most of them. He does a good job of really reconciling us. He said, Father, I've been down. I know what they are going through with. I know what they're facing with. I've been there. And that's why he's merciful. He's merciful. Even when we mess up and sin, he's merciful. Because all we got to do is tell him we're sorry. All we got to do is confess it. And he's faithful. And if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us, correct? Why? Because he's been here. He's been here. He's merciful. And he's faithful. Faithful. High priest. I don't have to go to no priest. I don't have to go to nobody. I just go right straight to Jesus. He's the high priest. He's still ministering, isn't he? Did his ministry stop when he left and went up to heaven? It stopped on the earth, but it didn't stop in heaven. We don't need no priest to go to. We can go right straight into the throne room of grace, and there's Jesus sitting on the Father's right hand. He is our faithful high priest. Thank God for that ministry pertaining to God, to make reconciliation, to bring us back to God, to reconcile us between God. Because you see, when you look at Romans 5:1, I believe it is, for therefore by through faith we have peace with God. Peace with God, that's reconciled. Peace is that deep, tranquil feeling. And we're reconciled. I've got, the war is over between me and God. I was a sinner and now I'm a saint. I don't act like a saint every once in a while, do you? Not all the time. Now I do pretty good, but sometimes I mess up. But it doesn't make any difference. I'm still a saint. A saint is a separated person. I've separated myself from the world, amen? You separate yourself from the world, that means you're a saint. But we saints need prayer. We saints need a great high priest, and we got one. So he reconciles us for the sins of the people. He did. He did that to God the Father. Hebrews 2:18. For in that he himself has suffered, being tempted? Wait a minute. This is the Son of God. Yeah, but ladies and gentlemen, you've got to understand the humanity of Jesus as well as the divinity of Jesus. And this is where many people can't get it. Many church people can't get the difference. What is the difference? Yeah, but he's the Son of God. Yes, but he is the Son of man too. He's got a human nature. He's got a human nature, and he was tempted. And I've went over this with my people at Hillcrest, and they know all about it. Some of you may be out there have never heard it, but so you're going to hear it right now. You're going to hear it right now. Are you with me? All right. Now, here it is. He himself suffered, being tempted. In other words, you mean to tell me that he suffered in the flesh? In the flesh he suffered. The devil tried to said, turn this stone into bread. No. Well, he could have. You see, the point Satan was trying to get, I understand that. I looked and I said, this is the point Satan is getting at. He's wanting him to leave his humanity. He's wanting him to step out of his humanity and step into his divinity and turn that stone into bread. Then he said, whoa, this is the Son of God, because I know what. Hey, he could do that. But just a human being couldn't do that. So Jesus didn't argue with him. You know what he said? Man shall not live by bread alone. You know, and the whole key to that, let me tell you folks that's never got this, let me tell you, and there's some of you out there maybe never got it, let me tell you, this one thing. Don't ever dialogue with the devil. When he tempts you, quote scripture to him. It's written. Quote scripture. Y'all have trouble with the devil? Well, if he ain't, he got you. Amen? I'm telling you, he will tempt you. He will exploit your weakness. And by the way, every one of us, those you listening to me today in Tennessee, North Carolina, wherever you at, you got a weakness, and the devil will exploit it. But quote scripture. Learn the key to it. Quote scripture. And he said, well, jump off the pinnacle of the temple. Angels will take care of you. Yeah, but God created gravity too, didn't he? And you better have some common sense. You jump off the top of this temple, see what happens to you. You'd be laying up here in a nursing home, broken legs and everything. Now, could God do it? Of course he could. Could the angels do it? Yeah. But he said, oh, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. He's using his humanity to resist the temptations. And then he showed him all the kingdoms of the world and said, if you'll just bow down and worship me, if you'll just bow down and worship me, I'll give you these. Interesting what he said there in that verse, that was delivered unto me. I'll give you the kingdoms of the economy. I'll give you those kingdoms of the world if you'll just bow down and worship me. No, you're not supposed to worship him but God, just God, no one else. Of course, you'll find that in Luke chapter 4, verses 1 through 13, the strategy, the plan of Satan. So, what is he? So he's been tempted. He's able. He's able to succor them. Now, what does that mean? Word we don't use much. First of all, he suffered, being tempted. He's able to succor them that are what? Tempted. You guys tempted? Everybody tempted? Everybody's tempted, right? One way or the other, you're going to be tempted. We're all that way. Now, who can help us? Psychiatrists? I'll tell you who can help you. Holy Spirit. God. God and Holy Spirit. He left him. Or he didn't leave him. He sent him back. Sent him back on the day of Pentecost. So he's been here to help us. We've all went through these times of temptation. He's able to succor us, help us. Book of Corinthians chapter 10, I believe, 2 Corinthians, 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians chapter 10. He will not allow you to be tempted above that you're able to bear, but we with every temptation make a way of an escape. Do you believe that? Amen. Amen, I believe that. Yeah, there's a way of an escape. He's able to help us. You know what that teaches me? That teaches me that Adam did not have to mess up. He messed up because he wanted to mess up. He messed up because... Interesting. Now, let me say this. I've got a little something I want to go over. Now, temptation is part of life. But how does the devil use it? I was talking to God about this. I said, okay. Now, Adam was in the garden. He's doing his work. And why didn't the devil go to him and tempt him? Who'd he go to? He went to his wife. Now, that's not saying that women are bad. That's not saying it at all, because some women are far greater Christians than men. But what I'm saying is it's a strategy of Satan. He will tempt you through other people. It might be your daughter. It might be your son. It might be a friend. He didn't go straight to the devil. I mean, the devil didn't go straight to Adam. I'm sorry. He didn't go straight to Adam. He went straight to his wife, and then his wife said, now Adam, well, of course he loved Adam. He loved his wife. And now she tempts him, and he says, okay, I got two options here. I can yield to the temptation, and I don't know what's going to happen to Eve. She's going to die. And then I can stay here, and I've got nobody and loneliness. And so what did he choose? He chose to take the fruit and ate the fruit, and therefore wherever she goes, I'm going. Whatever's going to happen to her, it's going to happen to me. The point I'm making is the devil can use other people to tempt you. Be careful. Be careful about that. I have to be careful about that. And sometimes they don't mean anything by it, but it can happen. And that's exactly what happened to Adam. And so, got to be careful. Got to watch his strategy. 1 John chapter 16. All that is in the world. And here's what he uses. He got a lot of weapons, ladies and gentlemen. Those of you out there listening to me, you know what I'm talking about. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, that's one of the things he tempts, is the lust, the things of the sensual nature of the flesh, and the lust of the eye, what you see and what you desire and what you covet, that's all part of the temptation. That's part of his repertoire of weapons. And the pride of life. Boy, I see that all the time. Amen. I see that in athletes. I see that in people. It's nothing but pride and arrogancy. And he uses that. That's part of the weapons that he uses. But it's not of the Father. That's not of God. But it's of the world. As I said, these are Christian weapons that he uses against Christians. All right, conclusion. What is the difference between the power of death and the fear of death? 1 Peter 5:8. Be sober. Don't be intoxicated with worldly stuff. Be vigilant. Be alert. Because here's the reason to be not be intoxicated. Here's the reason for being vigilant, being alert. Your adversary. Now, he's not the adversary of the world. The world serves him. He's the adversary of the believers. Us who are saved. He's our adversary. He's our enemy, the devil. He's as a roaring lion walking about seeking who he may devour. But you got to understand one little word. It's just a two-letter word there. When you understand the two-letter word, it'll give you understanding of the verse. What is Peter saying? Peter is saying, as the devil is as, that tells me he's a phony. Right? He's a phony. He's as a roaring lion. He's a phony. Now, he's an impersonator. He impersonates what? A lion. A roaring lion. You ever heard a lion roar? I've been to the zoo several times. And I've heard lions roar. I want to tell you about the hair stands up on the back of my neck. Good gracious, what a fear. I mean, that's just horrible. And that's what the devil does. He is as a lion. He's a phony. He's an impersonator. He impersonates a lion. That's what he does. But he's not the real McCoy. He ain't got no teeth. He's been detoothed. He can't bother a child of God. Amen? He can't bother us. He's walking about. He's seeking. He's looking for those he may devour. And it's usually Christians. He got the world. He already got them. The one he's looking for is you, ladies and gentlemen. If you're a believer this morning, I'm telling you, he's looking for you. But I got news for you. Christ said, greater is he that is in you, hallelujah, than you, he that is in the world. Don't worry. Don't worry. Jesus tamed that lion a long time ago. He took the power, fear of death, the power of death away from him. Took it away from him. Amen. Now, Revelation 1:18. Listen to what it says. I have the keys of hell and death, right? Who had the power of death from Genesis? For 4,000 years, who had it from Genesis to Matthew? 4,000 years, the devil had the power of death, and people horrified of it. He controlled them by the power of death. But yeah, now through Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and the epistles, Jesus said in the book of Revelation, I've got the keys now. He don't have the keys. I've got the keys. Thank God, aren't you glad he opened the door and let you out? I'm out. I'm free. Like the little girls were singing, thank God I'm free. I'm free. I'm free in the Lord. Amen. I don't have the fear of death. It's gone. That's gone. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse number 7. For God has not given us the spirit of fear. So if you have the spirit of fear, where does it come from? You can't say it comes from God, right? Because it'd be a contradiction to God's word, correct? If you said that I got fear, and I'm in fear of death. If you've got fear, you're saying that God's word's not true. For God has not given us, Christians, the fear of the spirit of fear. He hasn't given it. But he's given it. But notice what kind of spirit he has given us. He's given the spirit of power. Power. Power to resist. Power to overcome. Dunamis, that's where we get the word dynamite. It's powerful. More powerful than the devil. Powerful. And then he's given us a spirit of love. Love. You see, we have philo love. We love things because they appeal to us. That's not God's love. God looks at us, and looks at that sinner, that alcoholic, that drunkard, that dope addict. He don't appeal to them, but he's got agape love. He loves this part of them that's eternal, and that's their spirit, and that's what he loves. He's given us the spirit of love. And then he's given a spirit of what kind of a mind? Sound mind. You know what kind of mind that is? That's healthy. That's healthy mind. We've all got physical infirmities, right? You get in your 60s, hey, young people out there, let me say something to you. You don't know what pains and aches is till you get, you just wait. You in your 20s and 30s and 40s, you wait till you get into your 50s, 60s, and 70s and you have pains you didn't know exist, amen? You're going to have them. You might as well get ready for them. Going to have them. But let me tell you one thing. You can deal with them. You can live with them. We got good doctors, and them doctors can give us medications, and we can live with the physical infirmity. But when your mind's messed up, you're in trouble. Your mind's got to be healthy. The only way that you can have a healthy mind is when you say, Jesus, I'm a sinner. I'm lost. I'm going to hell. I want to be saved. Will you come into my heart? And when he comes in, bless God, your mind's healthy then. A healthy mind. He's given us a healthy mind. And then the Bible says, let this mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. Need to think like Jesus. I need to act like Jesus, right? Sound, healthy mind. Amen. I got something I want to show you. Oh, look at that. Big red apple. You like apples? Some people don't like apples. Tony Evans, one of my precious preachers that I love to hear. Tony Evans, black preacher in Dallas, Texas. He said, I don't like apples. I eat apples just about every day. I love apples. They're good for you. What is those cliche, an apple a day keep the doctor away? Well, I don't believe that. Because I eat apple and I still go to the doctor. Got to go in the morning. Just minor thing. But I love apples. Apples. Good for you. Absolutely good for your health. So, I thank God for that. I thank God for that. But I'm going to put another picture on there. Which one of those would you rather have? Huh? Say, preach, that's a crazy question. Of course I'd rather have this. Brenda, you'd rather have that chocolate one, wouldn't you? Of course. Man, I choose these anytime. But what's going on here? Over here, this thing is good for you. I mean, it's very good for you health-wise. But then this over here, when you put all this stuff over here, it covers up all the good stuff. And it neutralizes the good stuff in here, right? Because this is sugar and all that, and it's good tasting, but it's not good for us. So that's what the devil does. You see, you got a good part in here. There's a good part in here. But here the devil has, he's covered all that good part up. And once he gets it covered up, you see, you ain't worried about it. You just enjoy the pleasures of sin. Because let me tell you, as a sinner, you enjoy the pleasures of sin. It's enjoyable. Because, you see, it neutralized this good apple that's good for you. And here are these apples that are good but not good for you because it's covered up with all this stuff. And let me tell you, that apple has potential. And let me tell you out there, I don't care who you are. If you're listening to me today and you've never been saved, you've got potential. But the devil will cover your potential out to you up, and he'll get this on. He'll give you this and he'll give you that. And it will satisfy the lust of the eye and lust of the flesh and the pride of life. He will do that to you. That's kind of like this candy apple. It will cover it up. Don't let him do it. Don't let him do it. Don't let him do it to you. And another picture I want to show you, and I'm going to, the guy's got it here on the screen, but I want to show it to you. What happened there, Mark? Okay. I'm not, I don't believe I put this one on screen, but I'll show it to you. Anyway, now, the potential of a seed. I want to talk to you about the potential of a seed. And you can see this on Facebook. These are seeds. These are bean seeds. Okay, hypothetically, if I were to say to you, if I had a bean seed, I started to bring some, but I didn't. I started to take the picture. Now, if I were to take that seed right there and I were to lay it right down here on this podium, and I'm going to say to you, now next Sunday I'll come here and that seed will bring forth a bean, a vine. I'm going to lay it down right here and it's going to come forth and bring forth a vine. Correct? You don't think so? Why? I mean, you know, it's just a bean. There's life in it. There's life in that seed, but it ain't going to, it could lay there for what? 365 days? It could be laid there next year. Still wouldn't be. Still be a bean, right? But what if I were to go across the road here? We got a field right across here from our church. And I were to go over there and I plant this seed in that ground over there. And then we come back next week. I don't know. Now, it's got to have two things. It's got to have sunlight and it's got to have water, right? It's got to have sun and it's got to have light, water. If we had sun and we had light in a few days, we go over there and all at once, broke through the ground, there is a bean vine. What happened to the seed? It died. The seed died. But in order to bring life and nourishment, it had to be resurrected. Let me tell you something, person. If you're here today and you're not saved, you've got to die to the world. In order for you to have fruit and to produce fruit, you've got to die just like that bean seed. It's got to die. And here's what happens. When God planted and planted into the womb of Mary, Jesus Christ, He brought forth life. But when He died, He brought forth more life, because when He died and rose from the grave, He went to the heart of the earth, brought the saints out there, the Old Testament saints out, brought them out. They were resurrected, and He brought forth life. Let me tell you, when the Holy Spirit of God, when you die out to the world, if you die to the world, you'll have fruit. Fruit will come forth from your life. When you die to the world, fruit will come forth from your life. But you will not have fruit until you die to the world. Those people out there tonight, today, they're dead in the world. We Christians are dead to it. We're dead to it. We're not dead in it. We're dead to it. And these seeds have life in them. And the God seed that places in our hearts when you get saved, He puts that seed in there. And then that seed, I die to the world. I die to sin, but I'm alive in Christ Jesus, and I'm producing good fruit. Galatians talked about that. Chapter 5. Love, joy, peace, meekness, all that. Therefore, my life is to produce fruit. And the Bible says, by their fruit, you'll know them. Correct? We'll know them. You say, preacher, you judge me. No, you judge yourself. I mean, I have never seen an apple on a pear tree. It don't happen. When you're a Christian, you bear the fruit of a Christian. You got to die to the world. That seed dies, brings forth life. Aren't you glad you're dead to the world? You're dead to the world. You don't have, we're not out there in the world. We're in it, but we're not of it. Thank God I'm free. Thank God I'm free. All right, let's pray. Father, I am so grateful, God. The fear of death has been taken away. You have taken that fear of death away from me and away from us Christians. Hypothetically, there could be some Christian that might be going through some times of maybe. I've talked to a person this week, said I have doubts, and some do. And that's normal for Christians. We do have doubts at times. But not just overwhelmed with fear of death. We don't have that overwhelming fear of death. Jesus, you conquered death, hell, and the grave. And so today we can say, Lord, we're free. As a young girl sang that wonderful song, thank God I'm free. Well, we're free. But there could be somebody out there listening to this message that might not be free. God, I pray right now that they would pray the prayer. Lord, I'm a sinner. I want you to come into my heart. I want you to save me. I want to live for you. I dethrone myself and I enthrone you on the throne of my heart. I confess you with my mouth. I believe you arose from the grave. And then the Bible said, according to Romans 10:9, that I will be saved. Romans 10:13 says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. I present to you today the plan of salvation. Jesus loves you. Die to the world. Die to it, and you will produce the fruit of a Christian. I give glory and I give praise to you, Jesus, for this day. May this message have an effect on the people who listen and who watch today. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you.
All right, folks, I think we can move around.
What?